Ancient Greeks have attempted to understand the meaning of beauty and believed that the world is beautiful because of a certain order, harmony, measure, and proportion between its elements. For centuries, the golden ratio or the golden proportion has been considered as the perfect or ideal ratio for beauty. Interestingly, the golden ratio is also prevalent in nature, where it can be seen in the skeletons of animals and humans, in the arrangement of branches along the stems of a plant, in the spirals of seashells, and in the wing dimensions and locations of eye-like spots on moths. It would seem then that the golden ratio of beauty seems to be quite a universal law of attraction across the world. So how come there's been such a Eurocentric bias in the research, and is a multi-ratio facial golden ratio actually possible? We can look at the association of facial proportions and their relation to the golden ratio. For those of you who may not know what the ratio actually is, it's a special number that represents a fraction which is meant to represent the most aesthetically pleasing facial proportions to the human eye. First termed by Euclid, the ratio, which is 1.618, relates the size of one specific facial feature to another. As the ratio is greater than 1, the facial part represented on the numerator, or the top of the fraction, is a greater size than the facial feature represented on the denominator, or the bottom of the fraction. A great example of this is the golden ratio of the nose to the lips. Under the rules of the golden ratio, the perfect size, or the proportion of nose to lip, is one where the size of the nose is 1.618 times greater than the size of the lips, aka the nose is approximately 60% larger than the lips. Funnily enough, we actually saw very similar agreement and proportion when we looked at the circle of prominence theory. So it's likely that the golden ratio doesn't come from thin air, and it does have some truth to it, but it may not be as universal as it suggests, as we'll look at in this video. This ratio does have some important applications in facial aesthetics, as it is a quantifiable measure of beauty which experts can strive for, but it's not used that extensively because it's not very accurate for a large number of faces, and cultural trends mean that we desire different things now, like fox eye lifts and higher brow lines, all of which are things that the ratio doesn't account for, because again, it was discovered by the Greeks 2000 years ago and more recently made into a term by Euclid almost 200 years ago. The golden ratio has been criticized, like with most things in facial aesthetics, for its Eurocentric bias and lack of experimental evidence on a range of ethnicities. The main implications of this is that the field of aesthetics is limited in a range of populations due to the lack of scientific evidence on it. As well as this, the lack of cultural diversity in measurements means that clinicians can only draw upon Eurocentric evidence to further their own understanding, which may lead to the further spreading of Eurocentric bias across the world. For this reason, and many more, a study by Alam and colleagues in a Malaysian university investigated the association of facial proportion and its relation to the ratio, and then its relation to facial attractiveness across a Malaysian, Malay, Chinese, and Indian sample. The aim of the research was to further the ethnic diversity of the existing literature on the ratio, and essentially the researchers wanted to know if the ratio for facial appearance in a Western population was transferable for a Malaysian one. That particular study had seven main aims that all map into the wider concept of strengthening the diversity of samples for facial aesthetics research. The specific aims of that study include attempting to define what normal measurements should be for a facial feature in a Malaysian sample, attempting to identify the most common facial shapes of the Malaysian population, and to measure whether these common facial shapes map onto the ideologies of the golden ratio, and to see if the objective measurements of attractiveness positively correlate to the desired ratio of facial proportion as instructed by that golden ratio. The participants of that study consisted of a total of 286 subjects, including 100 Malay, 100 Malaysian Chinese, and 86 Malaysian Indian males and females from early adulthood. Interestingly enough, subjects of mixed ethnicity, or subjects with a craniofacial deformity, and subjects with a history of orthodontic treatment or facial surgery were excluded from the study. The purpose of this was to maintain as much strength in the findings of the study as possible, allowing the researchers to make specific inferences about ethnicities based on the data that they can collect. First, measurements of all 286 subjects were taken, and if we look towards the image here, the specific measurements included the upper facial height, measured as the length between the start of the hairline, or the tracheon, and the middle of the two eyebrows, or the glabella, or the base of the forehead. This upper facial height measurement looks like a normal forehead measurement, The second measurement is the middle facial height, measured as the middle of the two eyebrows, priorly defined as the glabella, and the bottom of the nose, seen here in the picture as the subnasal. The lower facial height measured is from the bottom of the nose or the subnasal to the apex of the chin or the mentone. And when all added up, the three measurements equal the total facial height. As a width measurement of the total face, the distance between the two extremes of the upper cheekbones were taken to give the bizygomatic width, with the zygoma meaning the cheekbone and bi meaning between the two cheekbones. Now, while I can all imagine that everyone listening cannot get enough of me saying trachea and glabella and subnasal, mentone and other seemingly made up words, hang on, aren't all words made up? I'm going to stop for a second, and as should you, to make sure that all of you get the time to like and subscribe to the channel, and this helps us with ensuring we can continue to make as much quality content as possible. After the measurements were taken, each participant was assigned a ratio that corresponded to a particular facial shape, and this facial shape ratio was then tracked to a specific category that was comparable to the golden ratio itself. This ratio measurement compared the total facial height from the mentone to the tracheon to the bizygomatic width. As an example, a total facial height of 20 cm and a bizygomatic width of 12 cm would be equivalent to a ratio of 1.67, which would be quite close to the actual golden ratio. When comparing these ratios, the researchers discovered that a ratio of 1.6 to 1.699 was considered an ideal shaped face, one that was less than 1.6 was considered too short, and anything greater than 1.699 was considered a long face. After the tedious measurements, participants filled out a questionnaire about the demographics and were then asked to rate the facial appearance of photographs of other participants. On top of this, the subjects were instructed to look back at their own photograph taken and were asked to respond to their own facial appearance, giving an answer that ranged from satisfied to very unsatisfied. With all the measurements that took place, including the anthropological measures of the Malay, the Chinese, and the Indian faces, as well as the demographic questions, the response of individuals, ratings of other people's, and the faces of their own, there were a lot of data outputs that can be looked at. First, we can see that the Malaysian Chinese subjects have always had the greatest facial height in both men and women, and as well as this, we can see that they have also the greatest facial width. This is quite expected because cheekbone reduction surgery is actually one of the most common surgeries for the Han Chinese, and similarly this extends to the Malaysian Chinese as well, because people want their faces to look more oval, and having wide cheekbones or a wide facial width increases the distance from your eyes to the facial boundary, which gives you a more masculine, boxy look. We can also see that for every ethnicity, the difference in total facial height and total facial width for men and women is quite significant. That should be expected. This shows that the overall facial height is a highly sexually dimorphic trait, and we've covered this many times with research literature in the past. When we look at these pie charts, we can see that for Malaysian Malays, a majority of men and women have a short face, so 50% in men and 60% in women fall in the short category of 1.6 or below, with only a minority having an ideal shaped face, with 24% of men and 8% of women. If we look towards the Malaysian Chinese pie graph, we also see a similar pattern, with the largest category of facial shape being short and only the minority being the ideal at 16% for males and 20% for females. Finally, the trend perpetuates for Malaysian Indians, with 56% of males and females having a short face and the minority having an ideal sized face. So from the numbers, only a minority of Malaysians in general, whatever ethnicity they are, fit into the ideal ratio that is defined by the golden ratio. However, and this is the very important however, this did not correlate to the amount of people who are satisfied with their facial appearance, and these ideal ratios that are talked about, or the golden ratio, do not positively correlate to people's ratings of others' facial attractiveness. In other words, there is no significant association found between the golden ratio and facial evaluation score among the Malaysian population. In short, the too long didn't read of the golden ratio is that it doesn't apply to people that are non-European and is quite Eurocentric as we've known and as research has shown, but it also means that it doesn't correlate to facial attractiveness scores in ethnicities and cultures that are beyond the Eurosphere. Rather, it would seem to me that the golden ratio reflects a prototypical face from 1,000 years ago that is just no longer in fashion. You know when we say, what era is your face from? This is kind of what we mean, and the golden ratio is not an applicable tool to use in facial aesthetics. That has always been my view, and I think we should be using anthropological research and measurement as this study does to actually determine what is attractive and what isn't. The implication of this study is actually quite significant. We need to redefine and reevaluate where emphasis is placed when attempting to objectively measure beauty standards. Because beauty standards do exist and objective measurements can be made, but they need to be done so correctly to make sure that these standards positively correlate to a range of cultures and to assume that they are not Eurocentric or ethnocentric in general. It doesn't even have to be Eurocentric. As well as this, an important avenue that this study took was actually asking the subjects about their own facial satisfaction. This type of questionnaire is rare in basic aesthetics literature, and it highlights something that would have otherwise been missed, that despite not fitting the golden ratio, these participants found each other's faces to be quite attractive and were still able to create an attractiveness hierarchy despite not fitting the golden ratio. That being said, the tenets of beauty, even according to the researchers, still apply, so symmetry, proportion, dimorphism, and averageness are still very important things that the most attractive faces had, but despite that, it's just that they didn't fit the exact definitions of the ratio as the Greeks initially proposed. Similar studies were conducted on the Japanese-Brazilian population, the Indian subcontinent, and the Thai populations, with similar results of, despite not fitting an ideal ratio, they were still able to create an attractiveness hierarchy, and all of these actually correlate to anthropological measurements, so actually going out there, taking measurements of an ethnic group, and using those as the specific reference for how you should determine attractiveness, rather than trying to define an overall universal measurement, like a golden ratio, which may not apply to every type of face. For the Coues Aesthetics Report, that's exactly what we do. We don't go out there, we don't take measurements of everyone's faces, but we do use datasets that are very ethnically specific. In fact, there are 27 datasets that we use, from Hungarian to Native Australian Aboriginal, and we use this because this is the better way of actually trying to attempt to define what facial beauty is, rather than trying to use a specific golden ratio that is supposedly meant to work for everyone, because as we see here, it does not. Speaking of the Coues Aesthetics Report, if you'd like one, visit the website and you'll get 7,000 words of technical feedback from our team of doctors and dentists to learn about what your strong and weak features are in terms of anthropological measurements, with very in-depth surgical and non-surgical feedback and a cost-to-benefit analysis.